Hello.
Mr. Adam Bergstrom.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning, Adam.
Good morning, Kate.
Good to hear from you. Thanks for being on.
Yes, thanks for having me on.
Oh, we love it. I wanted to say
good morning, Vietnam, like Robin Williams. But
right, like in the Robin Williams movie.
How are you?
I'm super gribalistic, prosafunksticacious.
I love it. That's great.
That's the best way to be.
Very well. We're in California. We're living the lifestyle.
Amen.
I know. That is so great. So I got your email, and I think you wanted to kind of touch on some color therapy. Is that kind of what you wanted to do a little bit of today?
Well, I'm willing to go any place you want to go, so we can talk about anything. That was just a suggestion.
I'm interested in that. I think that would be cool to touch on for sure.
Yeah, and we've had some weird stuff going on with us lately with numbers, so maybe we'll bring that up too.
Mm. Yeah, like, very powerful. They're archetypes.
Yeah, like we see 855 and 922 and 1111. And
it started with me. I think I remember emailing you, and then it happened to Justin. It doesn't stop.
Okay.
It's wild.
Yeah, we have a connection. You know, Carl Jung wrote about it and called it synchronicity, and a guy named Paul Camera called it seriality, but it exists.
Oh, my goodness. Okay, well, this will be fun to talk about that.
I want to get that guy's name. Was it Paul Camper?
Paul Camera, K-A-M-M-E-R-E-R. Oh. He was one of the first researchers that noticed that what Jung called an acausal connecting principle. In other words, usually something follows something else, like dominoes, you know, one event leads to another. Yeah. Uh-huh. But unrelated events, like you think of your uncle that hasn't talked to you for a year, and suddenly they call you on the phone.
Yeah, right.
Not linear.
Right.
Quantum.
Well, that'll be fun to talk
about.
Ooh,
I love this. Yeah, okay. Let's get into that.
Okay, cool. And I'm going to ask you, too, a little bit about parasites. Kate has a couple warts, so
we'll just
kind of chit-chat a bit. Okay, cool. You know, Adam, at the end of the show, would you be able to do a little intro for our show? Like, you'll probably hear it on today's show. We do a little intro of a guest, and he'll talk about his website and welcome people. Would that be something you would be willing to do?
I'd love to do it. I hear the way you do that. That's very good. I've seen other shows have done that, and I think it's a great idea.
Oh, cool. Okay. Yeah, maybe at the end.
Wonderful.
We'll do that.
What's your phrase about the juice? That's what I liked, the one I heard.
And we are juicing up the world. Was that the one?
That's it. That's such a great phrase.
Actually, that's so funny you said that, because that's the one that I have scheduled to play right now. So.
All right.
Synchronistic, right?
I know. That's
yes.
That's okay. Funny.
Cool. Awesome. All right. We're going to go live, so we will mute all of us. We'll get ready.
Okay.
Broadcasting live 4 days a week worldwide
from the sunny beaches of Southern California.
This is ExtremeHealthRadio.com.
G'day, this is Joe Cross from the movie Fat, Sick, and Nearly Dead and from RebootWithJoe.com. I'm on Extreme Health Radio with Justin and Kate, and we are juicing up the world.
No, Kate.
Yes?
We missed Mr. Joe Cross coming up from San Diego.
Gosh, I know. We got the email like a little too late, didn't we?
We are juicing up the world.
We are juicing up the world.
Yeah, we missed him. He was traveling up from San Diego up to L.A. and then up north on his new... He's got a new movie, Fat, Sick, and Nearly Dead 2.
Right?
So... Bummer we missed him, huh?
I know. It would have been so cool to meet up with that guy.
We could have got him a green juice, like we did with Ty Bollinger.
I'm sure he's lacking.
I'm sure he's lacking green juice.
I'm sure he is.
He's probably living on just green juice.
I know,
days.
Right?
So funny.
Yeah. Gosh, it would have been cool to meet with him, but we'll the right time.
You know what we'll do? Next time we go over to Sydney, we'll go have a green juice with him. How about that?
I agree.
Maybe sit out in Manly Beach or something?
Ooh. Good excuse to get on over back to Oz.
Have a little veggie juice.
Mm-hmm.
Joe Cross. Thank you, everybody, for joining us. Today is, for reference, what's the date today? I don't even know what the date is.
May 7th, 2014.
And Wednesday, May 7th, 2014. And this is episode 246. And, you know, Adam's been on seven times. He's on episode 225, 163, 116, 100, 89, and 78.
What?
Yeah. I did all that by memory.
Oh, no, you didn't. That's probably our longest standing.
I know, right?
Yeah.
Seven times. We love Adam. He's so great. We're going to be introducing him in just a moment. If you guys would like to support the show, you guys can. A great way to do that is if you go to Amazon.com through our link. And if you go to ExtremeHealthRadio.com/Amazon, every single time you make a purchase, that really does help us. It really, really, it's beneficial for us. And we make a few bucks on your order. And it doesn't matter what you buy. You can buy anything you'd like. And we don't know who buys what, but we just get a little commission. So it really does help us. So thank you all who have been doing that. And that's a way to support the show. And we broadcast live 4 days a week, Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. We take Tuesday off.
We do. Not for long, though.
Little midweek break, huh?
Mm-hmm.
So we broadcast live on those days, 9 a.m. Pacific.
Yep.
And if you would like to join the show, lots of different ways to do that. You can leave a voicemail. We have voicemail links on our website. You can record those straight from your computer, which is pretty cool.
And if you don't like it, you can re-record it.
I know, right? You can get it right. It just sounded just perfect.
Nifty little feature.
I know, right?
Nifty.
And
I start saying that more.
I know. That's an old word.
Yeah.
And you could also email us, Justin@ExtremeHealthRadio.com.
Or Kate, K-A-T-E @ExtremeHealthRadio.com.
To get your questions answered. And there's a chat room we have and a forum. So if you guys would like to participate in that, you can always be a part of those two things. They're all free. Everything's free on the website. So feel free to join the chat room. The actual live show page is ExtremeHealthRadio.com/live. And you can join that way. Get your questions answered. And today we have Adam Bergstrom.
Woohoo!
Yeah, I love his work. SolarMan111.com as well as SolarTiming.com. And he's, for those that don't know, he's been teaching workshops and seminars since 1977 across the United States.
Jeez.
He's got over 50 years experience in the health field and in nutrition. He counsels people with various diseases and ailments. He's been doing that since the 70s. He's the author of a book called Yes, No, Maybe, Chronobiotic Nutrition. And he studies chronobiology, reflexology, slit lamp iridology, meditation, Sufi, I Ching, and other holistic modalities. He graduated from O'Donnell Lay's Texas Institute Reflex Science since 1979.
I think he might have something to offer today.
He's got
or all seven shows.
Some opinions. So thanks so much, Adam, for being on the show once again. I appreciate it.
Thank you for having me. And I'm here on the seventh day for the seventh show of May.
That's right.
Of course you are.
Lucky seven. I was born on the seventh, too.
Were you really?
Yeah.
Wow.
Good number. One of my favorite numbers. Of course, I'm prejudiced.
Is the number seven, is that the number of completion or is that eight? Or
Completion is number nine. Ten is prosperity. And seven has to do with the seventh son of the seventh son type of thing. So it's a lucky number. All numbers are lucky. There's nothing wrong with any of them.
Yeah, they all have a specific meaning, don't they?
They all have different meanings, and they're archetypal. They come right out of the periodic table of the elements. We have odds and evens, the Odd Fellows Lodge, and there's the Even Women's Lodge.
Oh, my goodness. You know, a while back I heard somebody, I can't remember who said this, but I heard someone say I guess it was for abundance or for financial prosperity or something, to put the letter 8 in your wallet. Just draw the number 8 and put it in your wallet and keep it there. But I have no idea who said that and if that has any significance in terms of what that's supposed to be.
8 is a number of prosperity, and if you lay it on its side, it's the infinity symbol.
That's right.
And actually, if you look at a point on the wall and put your fingers together and move them in figure eights, you'll balance your brain. The corpus callosum is the bridge between both hemispheres, and it helps unite the two parts of our personality, the left brain and the right brain.
Wow. So the number 8 is powerful.
It's a powerful number. Very powerful. Carl Jung wrote about it often. And it's a number of completion.
So how do you think when people get, do astrology and they look at the exact time they were born and all that kind of stuff and how the planets align, how do you think that all plays out? Does it play out in people's lives, you think?
It has a basis in science. And if you notice, the odd numbers in the astrological signs are male. The even ones are female. That's the same in the periodic table of the elements. The odd are male. The evens are female. And it's the same in the I Ching, the Chinese Book of Changes. The odd numbers are male. The even numbers are female.
Wow. So this has been obviously studied for thousands of years. What do you think the first time they figured out? I guess sacred geometry goes back, way back forever, doesn't it?
It came out of the original physics. And let's look at a fairy tale. Scientists tell us there was nothing. And suddenly, within a few seconds, there was everything. The entire universe existed. Yet, they tell us for 300,000 years, there were no atoms. They didn't appear until you had male and female, known as hydrogen and helium. And they appeared 300,000 years after the universe was created. Now, any other fairy tale we want to hear, and anything supernatural, photon belts, ghosts, everything, that seems trivial compared to our scientific knowledge.
Wow. Do you think there's any relationship between, you know, how certain numbers, like you said, the 8 is for prosperity, or number 9, I think you said, was completion. Do you think there's any relationship between that kind of thing and like the flower of life and the sacred geometry and all that kind of stuff?
Definitely. Now, remember, the sacred geometry is only the second chakra. You have sacred chemistry as the first chakra, sacred geometry as the second chakra, sacred color as the third chakra, sacred chaos, which is a Dutch word for gas, as the fourth chakra, huh, and sacred sonics, ether and akasha, for the fifth chakra. So it's all levels going, yeah, like up an escalator or an elevator. And sacred geometry is only number 2 on our journey.
Wow. So a while back, Kate had a little experience, and she's been passing it to me, and then we pass it to our other friends. And so for some reason, Kate, you have had these crazy things going on with numbers. You'll look at the clock, right?
Yeah. Started about 8-9 months ago, maybe a little bit more. And every time I'd start looking at the clock just randomly, not like I was actually paying attention to see what time it was. I would just catch glimpses. It would be doubles, and then it went on to triple numbers. And now I just can't shake it. And I passed it on to Justin, and we passed it on to good friends in our lives. And we're just all laughing because it's like if we don't see it now, we're getting a little upset because we're so used to it. So what's going on with that?
Well, it shows you're living a synchronous lifestyle. Mm. Once you start most people live a linear life from birth to death. But there are people who live not horizontally like that, but vertically. And so your vertical extension of time is eternity. We actually live a life of eternity no matter how long we live. But we don't experience it because most people are programmed by their society that you're born, you go to school, you get married, you die, and that's it.
And it's more like a linear thing, right?
That's the linear life, but we really live a quantum life. Scientists know that now. You know, one photon of light can go through two places at the same time. The truth is it can go through a trillion places at the same time.
Well, really, it doesn't really travel at all, does it, or does it?
You know, that's a funny thing, because light takes no time to go no place, and it's the speed of light is actually the speed of time. So it's zero.
It's a
zero is the most powerful number in the alphabet. You put it before, you get infinity in the minus direction. You put it after, you get infinity in the positive direction. In fact, in the ancient Pythagorean system, the guy who invented the zero, they killed. The Pythagoreans were a cult, and it was very damaging to their paradigm. Zero. So they couldn't handle it. In the East, it went over a lot bigger. The Arabs got it from the Hindus and way back to the Tantrists.
Well, Kate, we must be living a pretty inspired life because we see these numbers. I'd say I'd see them on the clock. I'll look at the clock. It'll be 11, 11, and 11 seconds just randomly. And I'll look, I'll see that probably about 7 or 8 times a day at least. Mm-hmm. And I love it.
It's becoming funny, isn't it?
1111 is so powerful, you will find there are 5 or 6 books written on that subject alone, on that number alone. Really? Check it out on the internet. It's a powerful cosmic number, 1111.
Wow. Yeah, we have Janine in the chat room. She's saying she sees the same thing, 1111. So you know, I've heard when you see those numbers like that, you want to, I guess, take stock of what emotions and what you're thinking about at that exact time.
Hmm. That's a good idea, the exact time. And by the way, 1111 is the esoteric number of yes, no, maybe unified field. Because besides yes, no, maybe, the trinity, there's a quaternity, and that is the unified field. So it's a powerful number, maybe the most potent number, except for zero, of course.
Wow.
Have you ever heard, Adam, I've heard people say that pay attention to those numbers when you see them, and it means certain angels or angelic beings are trying to give you a message. Does that have anything to do with it, do you think?
Angels and angles are the same thing.
Angels
it means
angels.
The same thing. And they're, see, we give life to neurology. We say you have to be at least a molecule to be alive. That's not true. The ancients and even the moderns, such as the man who invented radio, was actually named Chandra Bose, not Marconi, not Tesla. He invented radio, and he found that individual minerals were alive, that platinum would actually enjoy its life and fear death. Scientists today can't even handle that now.
What do
they
you mean?
They will in 100 years or so.
Platinum, the actual mineral, would enjoy its life and fear death?
Platinum is actually one of the most alive and conscious minerals in the human body, much more than zinc. And zinc gets a lot of credit, doesn't it, for our prostate, a lot of things. But platinum is our connection with the solar wheel or timing or the 24-hour day.
Hey, Adam, here's something I've been thinking about recently. You know, ingesting more of these noble metals in your body, and you just mentioned platinum. Do you think that there's something to that, like taking the Ormus gold or the Ormus silver or something like that, and having that be a substance within your body that can help you resonate at a higher frequency?
I actually studied with David Hudson, who is the discoverer of Ormus. And let me put it this way. When people ask me, should they invest in David Hudson? And I said, hide your wallets and your purses. But if David Hudson gives another workshop, I'll be back to take it, because he was a very interesting man. But he didn't have the real secret of those elements. The secret of those elements is how they're processed through the plants and the foods we eat. And that is in the soil. You'll hear that we have like, what, 20 or so minerals of life. But actually, the minerals of life are 144. Many of them haven't even been discovered yet.
Really?
Life is the elements of the atomic periodic table of the elements, which is our intergalactic assigned housing program.
Wow. So when you ingest these kinds of substances, it's much more than just taking, you know, an alkaline salad or something. When you ingest these kind of noble substances, something within you starts happening, right? Something, you start becoming more aware of things. I really feel like that's the case.
If you eat natural foods, you can't avoid gold and silver and platinum and tellurium and all these mystical metals, and they all have a place. They're very small. You need minute amounts. Too much is too much. Just like if you take too much silver, there's a disease called argyria, where you actually turn silver. Your skin turns silver. It doesn't seem to hurt people, but it's too much silver. It's not a good idea to go get a tan when you're silver.
Yeah. I heard just recently that guy passed away recently, the guy who took too much silver.
There's quite a few. In fact, there is a family of people down in the South that are blue, the color of Krishna. So we have various colored people. I heard your discussion about black and white, and of course there is no black and white. It's a variety of rainbow power people.
Yeah, It's I really feel like that. A lot of people, I feel like that whole black and white thing, people, you know, I just really feel like it's that whole language is meant to keep us away from one another.
It's all degrees of color and degrees of brown, actually, because all of us are colored with melanin, one of the major colors. Carotenoids tend to make the Asian people have more carotenoids in their skin. So-called white people have more calcium in their skin. So-called black people have more melanin. But everybody has melanin in their skin, or they couldn't tan. Actually, there is an exception to the rule. Albinos, they don't have any melanin, or very not enough to show.
Hmm.
What do you make of people that are allergic to the sun? Have you heard about people like that?
Yes, and I would go to the emotional trauma behind it first, and the emotional trauma from their parents or their parents' parents, because it can be passed down. The gene, of course, is a really inadequate explanation of how we come to exist and how we came to form.
Yeah, I find that fascinating. People that are allergic to the sun, that just seems like such a wild concept.
Contradiction.
Yeah.
It's almost like being allergic to life when you think about it. But there are people who have that reaction, and they can be cured of it. So
they can be.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. People. But I've met people like that. I met one of the best athletes in the world. His name escapes me right now, but he had to come out and do his athletics at dawn, before dawn or after dusk.
Whoa.
Oh, my
goodness.
He
couldn't be exposed to the sun at all.
So what happens to their bodies if they're exposed to the sun?
Well, they break out in a rash. They get various diseases. The same thing happens to them in minutes, what would happen to us if we went out in the middle of the Sahara Desert and had never been out in the sun for like months, and suddenly we got exposed to the sun. We would be burned up to a crisp or damaged. Our DNA would be destroyed, etc. And by the way, a suntan is a neurological or is a reflex condition, because you're suntanned with your adrenal glands. People get mixed up about that. If your adrenal glands weren't functioning, you would burn up. So an allergy to the sun is essentially a problem with the adrenal glands and with a person's phenylalanine and tyrosine metabolism.
Wow. So what about people who have albino skin? Is that, that's not an allergic reaction. That's just they can't take any sun, right? Their body doesn't know what to do with it?
Yes, they have a melanin deficiency, a severe melanin deficiency. And sometimes people have the karma. They come in with that. They could probably work on it and somewhat clear it up as a possibility with simple hypnosis. You know, hypnosis used to be a huge movement, a world movement, most centered around Franz Anton Mesmer, where they would cure people of every disease in the book from A to Z. But that got repressed by the medical association, including in the U.S. Remember, five medical doctors signed the Declaration of Independence, and the medical movements couldn't handle competition that you could sit in your own chair and heal yourself without putting the single thing in your mouth other than the breath that you breathe.
Oh, my gosh. We have to take a little break.
Of course, that's interesting.
I want to talk more about that. That sounds fascinating.
Your eyes lit up over there.
Oh, my gosh. That's just too good. We're with Adam Bergstrom. If you're interested in checking out his website, it is solarman111.
And, of course it is.
Or .com, I should say, solarman111. And you can check out his book, Yes, No, Maybe, Chronobiotic Nutrition, as well as solartiming.com. I'll put a link to both of those right now in the chat room so our chat people can check out those while we're on the break. This is just a fascinating show. Again, we broadcast Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday at 9 a.m. Pacific on the live show page. So you can join that and get your questions answered, listen live, and join the party. Right?
It is a party.
Now we're going to talk a little bit about Barf World.
Okay, let's do it. That's always a party.
Right back right after this break. Did you know that conventional dog food contains antibiotics, herbicides, pesticides, ground up carcasses from roadkill subjected to high heat processing, artificial colors, chemical preservatives, way too many carbohydrates, genetically modified corn syrups, indigestible grains, and a lack of moisture content in the dry kibble? Obviously, this can lead to health conditions like diabetes, itchy skin, teeth and gum problems, liver damage, obesity, behavioral issues, pancreatic problems, and even cancer. That's why we recommend the Barf Diet, which is the biologically appropriate raw food diet from Barf World. Their unprocessed raw meats contain bone, organ meats, vitamins, and minerals that are loaded with enzymes. Barf World founder Robert Mueller explains more.
Sure, I don't have to convince you on the damage that's caused by high heat to food. So as a result, we see many skin disorders, a lot of arthritis, obesity, heart disease, cancers. I mean, it's just rampant. The vet clinics are just full of these conditions. And basically, a large percentage of the commercial pet food that's made is made up of the human industry leftovers. And the pet food industry makes use of this waste product. And in addition to that, we are subjected to the products coming out of the rendering plants. Garbage in, garbage out. If you feed garbage to your dog, you're going to end up with garbage health. And all if you put the right gas in, your engine runs smoother and lasts longer. So if you put the right fuel in the tank, you're going to get the right output. Garbage in, garbage out.
We've seen an immense difference with our dog Maggie being on this diet. Give your dog the gift of health today by going to extremehealthradio.com/barf or go to our store. That's extremehealthradio.com/barf to learn even more.
In today's modern world, we're surrounded by magnetic radiation, electric fields, radio waves, microwaves from our cell phones, our laptops, our computers, iPads, and even cell phone towers and power lines. These EMF frequencies damage the blood-brain barrier, they cause sleep problems, they decrease melatonin, and disturb our electric bodies. After much research, that's why we recommend a company called Less EMF. Listen to what founder Dr. Emil de Toffel has to say.
The dangers of radiation. Where do you even begin? There's many different kinds of radiation and there's many different kinds of dangers. Modern electronic devices will emit a variety of electromagnetic fields. Electric fields, magnetic fields, radio waves, and microwaves. This type of radiation has been associated with a variety of health effects, including cancers, headaches, sleeplessness, ADD, diabetes, and more. The effects seem to be cumulative, and our exposure seems to be cumulative as we're adding more and more electronic devices in our world and spending more and more time with each one. Radiation levels and the type of radiation from these devices vary, but its impact seems to accumulate in the body. So we do have shielding of a variety of different kinds. We have shielding metals to control magnetic fields, shielding canopies to put over your bed. So if you have an electromagnetic situation, we probably have a solution for it.
Protect yourself and your family today. They've got very affordable products for all of your portable devices, your home, and more. Visit extremehealthradio.com/less EMF. That's LESSEMF. Or check them out in our store to see videos. Again, go to extremehealthradio.com/less EMF.
Listener-supported. Extreme Health Radio. Opening minds and transforming lives worldwide. Don't forget to join our thriving community for health tips, inspiration, and show updates at extremehealthradio.com/Facebook.
Kate, I have to tell you something.
What?
Let's see. On our Facebook account, it says, Alston wrote in and says, has anyone figured out the lyrics of that song? Roll, and he says, roll over me sounds something like a river does. Could the lyric be Tallahatchie roll over me?
Interesting.
I know, right?
I want to believe it's Tallahatchie, but it just when you really listen to it, I don't hear the T. I hear like a... I don't know. I don't know what I hear. It's funny, though.
Oh, my gosh. That's hilarious.
Well, I love that people are trying to help us figure it out.
I know. We'll get to the bottom of
roll
it.
Roll over me. I like that, though.
We'll put some scientists, a team of scientists.
With all our extra time. We'll work on figuring out the lyrics.
Yeah. Hopefully, you guys are enjoying the show. We're having a great time here with Adam Bergstrom, solarman111.com, solartiming.com, and just a great, great guy doing some great work with people. And if you guys have any questions about the barf world, we got Maggie on that diet now. She seems to be doing crazy amounts of energy, doesn't she?
I walked her yesterday, and not only did we ran the whole walk. Like, she just darted through this park, and usually she has little bursts. She ran the whole park.
That's crazy.
Last night, I thought, this dog in the barf diet, she's killing me.
Yeah, she's got lots of
giving me
of
a run for the money, huh?
Yeah, if you have any questions about the Less EMF, we spoke with Dr. Emil de Toffel, too. He's in our store. You can check that out. Lots of great stuff on their website. We use some of their products here, so... hopefully you guys enjoy that, and we broadcast 4 days a week, Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. That's right, Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday.
That's right, there you go.
9 a.m. Pacific, and so you can join the chat room and join the show that way. And Adam, So before the break, you said something that really piqued my interest. You're talking about how the medical medical industry wants to suppress that knowledge of how people can actually just heal themselves through meditation. That's very, very interesting.
Yes, there were millions of people practicing mesmerism in the world about the time of the French Revolution. In fact, the French Revolution had a lot to do with suppressing mesmerism. The doctors wanted control of it because they knew and experienced the placebo effect, that they could actually just suggest to a person that they get well. And even more than that, they could put them into a hypnotic state by using a certain frequency, a certain note on a piano, whatever, and they would heal themselves without any suggestion whatsoever. In fact, James Braid, one of the pioneers in hypnotism, never suggested anything to anyone. He just put people in a hypnotic state called hypnotic induction, and they healed themselves. Wow, because hypnosis is a very small term for a very large area involving all kinds of what might be called realms of consciousness, from the delta brainwave on to the amiga brainwave.
Did you say that was James Braid?
James Braid. He was one of the people most credited with modern hypnosis, but he was one of millions. And so our history forgets that. The Marquis de Lafayette, who was basically considered the adopted son of George Washington, was a mesmerist. He hung out and was an honorary member of the Iroquois tribe. His friend, Chief Great Grasshopper, was very familiar with mesmerism. In fact, it even spread to Haiti, and what we call voodooism is actually a combination of African beliefs and Franz Mesmer's hypnotism.
Would mesmerism be considered today, would be somewhat like a psychic or like a hypnotist or something like that?
It has a wide realm. Mostly it's considered hypnosis now, but actually it spreads out a lot more than that. Even Galvani and Volta, where we get the terms volt and galvanic, they were mesmerists, as was Mozart, as was Marie Antoinette, as was Madame du Barry, as was Haydn, the composer. They were mesmerists.
Isn't that wild? You know, it's interesting with this whole thing, because I think the point of what you're saying was that when people start healing themselves, the powers that be don't like that. It's so fascinating because it really does take a lot of ingenuity and desire to really get to the bottom of your own health issues, because it's so easy for a lot of people just to take a pill or go to their doctor. But to diagnose and to treat yourself really does take a lot of effort, a lot of work, and I suspect maybe part of the healing comes from just that part alone.
Yes, go within, and that's where the secret is, of course. Know thyself. It's been around for a long time. Once you know yourself, you don't need external healing. Until then, it's okay to have trainer wheels, you know. We need supplements. We need certain foods and things like that. But ultimately, we're here to realize that we're far greater than what society wants to pigeonhole us as.
Yeah, and I think that the society seems to do everything they can to prevent us from going within and knowing intuitively that something's right or wrong. Or, you know, it seems to be like we're always looking at or worshiping or idolizing people of authority so that we'll look to them for answers. It seems like a lot of that going on.
Adolescence is a made-up word to juvenilize the public so they can get a hold of them before they can get their information. You know, Admiral Farragut commanded his first ship at 11 years old.
Who was this guy?
Admiral Farragut of the Revolutionary War, and who fought the Barbary Pirates. He was 11 years old when he took his first command of a ship.
What?
He didn't go to school. Yeah, a lot of the historic people were 11 or 12. You know,
Joan of Arc?
Cornelius Vanderbilt dropped out of school, grammar school. Rockefeller dropped out of grammar school. J.P. Morgan dropped out of grammar school. They got along quite fine without an education because they self-educated themselves with life experiences. Our schools keep us away from older people, wiser people. They put us with teachers who are brainwashed themselves by the schooling system to further brainwash us and tell us that we are children and we can't run multi-million dollar companies. Mm. Now, a lot of people in the computer industry military are dropping out of school and making $1 million. One I read about was 9 years old when he retired.
Oh,
that was in 1990s.
Oh, my gosh. He should write a book.
I know, right?
How to retire early.
His name escapes me now, but it was a front page story at the time.
Oh, my gosh.
Hey, Adam, what do you think the biggest detriment, you're just talking about school, and you know, as you're talking, I'm just thinking of all the different things. You know, with people going to school, there's the vaccinations, and I just read a story recently that they're not, in certain parts of the country, allowing mothers to send their lunches to their with their children to school. And there's then you have on top of that the different things they're being taught, maybe the disinformation or disempowering stuff. What if there is such a thing as the number one most detrimental thing that you think we're exposed to by going to school? What do you think it is?
Teachers.
Really?
Education. Yeah, you know, our school system in this country is not an educational system. It's based on the Spartan system, which was then part of the Prussian caste system, and also the worst of India was their caste system. That's where the American system is designed on. There were many great teachers in India, but the caste system was a social system separate from the meditation system, and that was borrowed by the Rockefellers, the Morgans, their foundations, and later the Ford Foundation too came along for the ride because they realized they wanted an elite group of people to be in control of the country. And by the way, they believed they were doing the right things. They thought that the mob was stupid and they would mess things up, and so they had to run the world in like little children. And so to make a self-fulfilling prophecy, they juvenilized people. Again, many other people rebelled. Louis L'Amour, the famous Western writer, he dropped out of school at about 15 because, as he put it, they couldn't teach me. They interfered with my education. So he went out and became a hobo. And he got his education out of libraries, and he read 400 nonfiction books a year. Oh, without fail, even while he was a logger, a miner, a merchant marine, all of these professions that he did. And not only that, that's not even counting the fiction books. And we're talking Chaucer, Shakespeare, authors like that was his light fiction material.
Isn't that wild? You know, it's so funny. If you were to put a guy like that and cram him up in a classroom today, his ability and desire to want to learn, that's the whole thing, is wanting to learn. You know, that just kind of goes out the window in today's school system, doesn't it?
ADHD is a made-up disease. It's to stop you from dancing.
Yeah. Oh, man.
Yeah. And I say that with truth because a famous choreographer was brought to a doctor, and the girl just sat there, sucked her thumb, and made weird motions and darted her eyes around. And the doctor realized right away what the real problem was. And so they left the room, and the doctor turned the radio on. They looked back through the window, and the little girl was dancing. And the doctor said, "She's not sick. She's a dancer." And she became one of the greatest choreographers of all time, the musical Cats and et cetera, et cetera.
That's so
fascinating.
You know, it's weird with me, ever since I have gotten out of school, I feel like I've learned probably 5 to 10 times as much as when I did when I was in school. And my desire to learn is increased exponentially because everything that I want to learn, it's there because it's inside me. I have that desire. And when I was in school, the last thing I wanted to do was to read books or to learn anything. And so I feel like for a lot of people, if they can just tap into what they're really passionate about or what they're really interested in, they will learn a lot.
As one man put it, how can you get inspired doing low-grade clerical work? That's really what you're doing. You're isolated from nature. They call you ADHD if you look out at the beautiful green world out there, the trees swinging in the breeze and the birds. You look out the window, you can't pay attention. Yeah. You're diseased. We got to put you on Ritalin. They tell us not to take speed, and then they give us speed as part of the educational process. Very interesting.
So, Adam, if you had any kids, I'm presuming if you guys had kids now, say you were earlier on in life, would you put your kids through school? I was guessing no.
I would self-educate. And by the way, I'm a great grandfather.
Are you really?
Yeah, been around the sun quite a while.
Wow.
Great-grandfather.
Awesome.
Wow.
That is so amazing. So you would just do the homeschool thing?
I would do some kind of homeschool thing and educate my children to go to the greatest educational thing we have in this country, brought to this country by Benjamin Franklin, the public library. Mm-hmm. I have been in libraries from New Zealand to Hawaii to Boston to every place. I probably in my life had had about 60 or 70 library cards, and I've been in a lot of other libraries. I didn't have a card. University libraries, medical libraries. I got my education, my real education, in libraries. Wow. And now on the internet, thanks to the internet, anyone who doesn't have an education isn't interested in getting an education or doesn't know that they can't get an education on the internet because all the books in the world are being put online by thanks to Google Books and other educational systems. We don't have to read blogs. We can read all the great books of the world. Hmm. I read books from back in the 1600s in their entirety and 1700s and 1800s. They're all online now or they're coming online.
Yeah, so people are just transcribing those into an ebook format kind of thing?
That's right. That's right. They're all there.
In that way, there's never been a better time to be alive. I mean, you can inform yourself. It's all out there at our fingertips, finally.
Yeah.
Probably
yes,
not
and
all.
There were people back in the 1800s that could actually speak 8 or 9 languages that were much more worldly than the jet travelers of today. They knew more about the world than the people today who have more access to the world. They had the educational access, and many of the libraries have been destroyed, starting with libraries before the Library of Alexandria, the libraries at Constantinople. Great libraries all over the world have been destroyed systematically to destroy the knowledge. What scientists think they have today is just a dim shadow, the soup of the soup of the soup of real knowledge.
Hmm.
You know what's awesome is that you can just peel what we're just talking about into any particular subject, whether it's politics or finances or health or anything. You can really, when you start doing your own studying, you realize that everything we've been told is just complete nonsense, I would say. I mean, there's so much beyond and deeper if you go into these different subject matters, which is really cool because it makes life so much more fascinating and more interesting to know there's so much more going on than what we're being told.
That is true. A lot of Americans don't know that. We were in Vietnam before the Civil War. We were in the Middle East before the Civil War. We were all over the world, but the four corners of the world before the Civil War. But they call that in your school books the isolationist period.
Yeah.
Well, that's a bunch of bunk. People were international in the 16th and 17th century. And, of course, there were people who were confined. For instance, when I was in Texas in the 1960s, I met people who never were out of the county for their entire life, and they were like 80 or 90 years old.
Wow.
So that exists, too. But there was a group of people throughout history who were very, very cosmopolitan and global.
Oh my goodness!
So here's,
and many people knew the world was round way before Christopher Columbus.
Yeah,
oh, I'm sure. Well, here's a golden question. So, in your opinion, and from your studies, where do you think Jesus was all those years that he's not talked about in the Bible? Do you think he was in other places in the world?
Very likely, he went to India. People traveled a lot more than we give them credit for. In fact, the Iroquois discovered England before many of the Europeans discovered America.
Wow.
The Native Americans travel a lot. Right here where I live in Santa Barbara off on the islands, they have found remains of bones with mastodons. There were people in the United States a long time ago. One theory, and there's evidence to support it, is that the Garden of Eden was in San Diego, California.
Oh, my God.
Where did you
and then we
that?
Evolved into Europe, that it was actually formed here.
Where did you hear that? That's fascinating.
There are books written on that. The one of the authors, his name escapes me, but it's in the public library. Wow. That doesn't mean it's true. All the information, a lot of what we know could be fairy tales. You know, one of the latest things on aging now, the whole thing is shifting. Now they know that free radicals are more important to longevity than antioxidants. And they also know that that we don't age by lipofusion and get Alzheimer's from plaque in the brain. We get it from many strokes, thousands and millions of them that occur and destroy the brain. That you can have all the plaque in the world and still be sharp and alert at 120.
So you could have just a million or ton of these mini strokes and not even know it?
Yes, we get all of these old doctor's tales, and then we just believe them. Something's passed around. This does that, that does that, and we just swallow it hook, line, and sinker.
Wow, that's just so crazy. There's so much. That's what I'm saying before. There's just so much, whether it's health or politics or anything you want to study, there's just so much that we've been, like Adam just said, you know, taking hook, line, and sinker. And there's so much more going on. It's just fascinating.
To me, education is teaching people how to think, not what to think. And that's what happens now. It's what to think. This is a fact. Remember it. Mm. And then people, they subvert their own experience in life and say, well, that can't be true. That didn't really happen to me. I've actually changed the date on my driver's license. But that's impossible, right? In fact, right here, about a month ago, my significant other and I both witnessed that the lid of our glass cooker was broken, was cracked, and it healed itself. Now, if I saw that and she didn't, she would have thought I was crazy, and vice versa. So anyway,
wow.
Things happen that we can't really explain in nature, and of course, then it couldn't have happened.
Yeah, right?
Gosh, right?
This stuff is so fascinating. We're with Adam Bergstrom. We're going to take a little bit of a break here. This is just such good stuff. And by the way, Adam, as you were talking a couple of minutes ago, I looked down at our little recorder that records these conversations.
Yes.
Two different times, and one was 44:11, and the other one was 44 minutes, 44 seconds. Just, of course, you know, it's just so random, but not, you know.
Synchronicity.
So we're with Adam Bergstrom, solarman111.com and solartiming.com. Just fascinating stuff. I love this kind of information. Talk all day about this kind of stuff. So we'll be right back with Adam right after this break.
If you are currently using any hair care products that contain dyes or colorings, these things can be carcinogenic. You see, anything we put on our skin, even in the shower, gets into our bloodstream and causes a toxic overload to our organs over time. That's why we only recommend Morocco Method hair care products, because they're 100% chemical free, 100% organic, raw, vegan, and even wild crafted and picked according to the lunar cycles. Listen to what our guest Anthony Morocco says about foaming agents in the shampoos.
Well, number one with hair care is the sodium lauryl sulfate, which is a foaming agent, which is really carcinogenic, and it's very, very toxic. So that's number one. And so they're so afraid of it, the industry has made 38 different names for it. They've created cocamide, they've created coconut, they've created palm oil. But anything that foams is sodium lauryl sulfate. So I would say that you really need to read your ingredient lists. And if you cannot pronounce the word, it's made in the laboratory.
So would even organic hair care products that foam, would those be damaging as well?
Yes. Organic really today is not what it used to be. So it's just the word. It really, to me, is not reality. If you want a real product, you want to look at wild craft.
As a former hairstylist, I love Anthony's products. If you'd like to have truly healthy and luxurious hair, no matter what your texture, go to extremehealthradio.com/MM for Morocco Method, or see it in our store. Again, that's extremehealthradio.com/MM to learn even more.
If you have any digestive problems whatsoever, I highly recommend getting a squatty potty that sits right underneath your toilet. Squatty potties help give relief from constipation and bloating, hemorrhoids and straining, IBS, pelvic floor and bladder issues. See, as humans, we are designed to squat when we eliminate, and when we sit on a toilet, that angle kinks and pinches off the puborectalis muscle in your colon, and the squatty potty opens the colon to eliminate more quickly and completely. Listen to what Daniel Vitalis has to say about that.
One of the reasons I love to promote the idea of the squat toilet is because, for a couple of reasons. One, there's a ligament that wraps around your colon that prevents you, when you're in the seated position, from being able to have an effective bowel movement. But that ligament's loosed when we're in a full squat. So people are fighting their own body to defecate this way. Now, in the rest of the world, people defecate in the squat. Use a squat toilet. I'm so big on this. I've got a video on my website about that. But I really believe that it's important we start to actually defecate in an anatomically correct position. So, you know, nobody sits on chairs to defecate except people in the West. And we have more rectal and bowel problems than anybody, more constipation than anybody. But this actually puts our body in a disadvantageous position for trying to go to the bathroom. So if you don't have a squat toilet or don't want to invest in one, I don't know, stack some books up. But get something where you can actually squat up above the toilet or at least get your knees up higher.
Justin and I love our Squatty Potty. Start improving your digestion and elimination today by going to extremehealthradio.com/squat or see it in our store. Again, go to extremehealthradio.com/squat and watch the video to learn more.
Free shows all the time on Extreme Health Radio. Opening minds and transforming lives worldwide. Join our community today. Sign up to our email list and instantly get our free gift to you, along with loads of inspirational content and cutting-edge tips to help change your life at extremehealthradio.com/subscribe.
All right, we're having a great time here with Mr. Adam Bergstrom. The sun's coming out a little bit here, so that's always a good thing, right?
Yeah, we usually have this, what do we call it, May gray, June gloom by the beach.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah, looks like it's breaking through.
It's a California thing.
It is a California thing.
May gray, June gloom. But the sun's breaking through, and we're having a great time here. This is episode 246, is that correct? Yep, 246.
246.
And we'll put a link to every show that Adam's been on our website if you guys are interested in listening to past shows. They're all just so fascinating. This is one of the most fascinating people I've ever spoken with. Just great information. And I have a couple of things I want to bring up in just a moment about our parasite cleanse that we're doing, Kate.
Good night.
And parasites in general. And also, what's going on with your warts, too?
Well, I know.
So we'll bring that up in just a second.
Or whatever they are.
Yeah, whatever they are. But you wanted to ask Adam something about counting. Is that correct?
Yeah, Adam, it's interesting. In the chat room, I've been going back and forth with Tana, a friend of ours, about how her husband also seems to catch the clock throughout the day at certain numbers. And we both, she said, my husband, he's not the rain man, but he also has this thing where he counts things, like he likes to count closed circles. And I wrote back to her, oh my gosh, I'm a counter too. I'll count, like, you know, lines on a wall or count. Why do we count things? What is that?
It's a natural phenomena of our body because we're made out of mathematics. So we're just returning to our roots, which is mathematics. The periodic table of the element is based on 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 on up, the counting system. So we're – even in the Bible, it's an interesting thing. It says we created heaven and earth. That's basically sperm and ovum. So we start as a duality right off the bat.
Hmm.
And so it's kind of just in our nature to look at the ceiling if we're laying down and count little squares or something like that?
It would be unnatural if one didn't do that.
Wow.
So it's a very natural thing and very beneficial, especially when you start to draw connections between it. Then you're going into you're leaving the realm of linear reality to the synchronous state. And we really live in a synchronous state. It's like photo finishes when two horses come in together. Uh-huh. Now, if all the horses come in at the same time in the race, that's called nirvana.
Interesting. So when you're looking at the ceiling, like sometimes, you know, when I was a kid and you get the popcorn on your ceiling, you would look and you would imagine or see things in the ceiling. Remember that?
Yeah.
You would see a person
or a
sunset or something. You can kind of imagine. Is that kind of what you're talking about, getting into that imaginative state?
Yes, and it comes from the eyes. People think that math develops in the brain, and it has a connection there, but actually it's from the eyes. Down in San Diego, there's a great mathematician. He can just, you know, what is the square root of 1,870,423,121? And he will give you the answer instantaneously. Well, they put him through a CAT scan to see how his mathematical part of his brain was developed. And it was his eyes that were developed. So you can do more for your mathematical skills and make these numbers come on quicker if you do eye movements. Rapid eye movements in your dreams are also the figure eight. The figure eight is something that will develop your connection with mathematics and your connection with balancing the hemispheres, where you too can be a mathematician.
So when your body makes those or does those figure eights during sleep, during rapid eye movement, that's its way of maybe recalibrating to that math or something?
Yes, it's a way of cellular cleansing. You actually cleanse your body, and if you want to get rid of parasites, dream. Ultimately, the purpose is to dream so much that you don't need to dream anymore. That's called taria, or the dreamless state. Now, that isn't to be confused with repressing one's dreams, which actually is a way of escaping cellular cleansing. And the way you know for sure is that you get an REM movement where your eyes are rapidly moving. And the other way is to be sure you're dreaming is that a male gets an erection and a similar thing happens to a woman. That shows they're dreaming. You cannot dream without a reaction of the kundalini in the genital area.
Huh.
Impossible. Oh. Hmm.
So even if you have a stressful dream or a scary
stressful dream too, yeah. It's basically stressful sex.
So if you're not dreaming, for example, I don't seem to dream. I may dream, but I just don't remember it really that often. I might remember one dream a month. What's going on with that?
You can bring on the dreaming. Now, dreaming, there's two ways of dreaming. Lucid dreaming is the most powerful. That's where you actually can go places in your dream. It's called astral projection, lucid dreaming, various things. Uh-huh. And you can even predict the future with it. They used to do that a lot. Great prophets came down the line that did that as a matter of course. That's what the dreaming is for, to blend with the or to become part or one with the unified field. But it would be a good idea to cultivate dreaming, and one of the ways to do that is to watch birds. Strangely enough, if you watch birds and then you start to dream, one night suddenly you will find yourself levitating or flying in your dreams. The thought will come to mind, wait a minute, humans can't fly. An educational concept, by the way. Humans can't fly. I must be dreaming. And then instead of waking up, stay in the dream. Then you will start lucid dreaming and realize you're in a whole other dimension.
How can we train ourselves to lucid dream? I mean, I've always wanted to know how to delve into that, because I had the flying dreams all the time. And like you said, it's where I go in my dream, I'm pretty sure I shouldn't be flying or I can't be flying. And then I just snap out of it. So how do you train your brain to stay in that place?
Multiple ways. The first way is to expose yourself to a certain amount of sunlight, not too much, but if you go out between 11:30 and 12 noon and don't look at the sun, but just expose yourself to sun at that time for 5 or 10 minutes, and then if you go and sit under a green tree, green trees emit shortwave infrared radiation, and they accelerate and stimulate the dreaming process. The other thing is to, if you go driving, have you ever driven for a long period of time and suddenly you close your eyes and you see you're dreaming without even being asleep?
Yeah.
Yeah,
that's a mystic state, they call it. It's basically an REM state, and it's very important for brain development. So you can stimulate these in numerous ways.
Wow.
So I had a friend that I knew, and she would, in college, she would study her books. It was really fascinating how she did this. She would study her books for her classes and things like that. And then what she would do is she would go to sleep and lucid dream and reread those same books in her dream to study up for a test. So she'd be like rehashing the information in her dreams.
That's right. Edgar Casey's method was to put the book under the pillow at a 45-degree angle, and then you know what's in the book when you wake up.
You know what I heard? David Wolf does this. This is so fascinating, too. I bet you could do all of these things. But he would put a glass of water on top of a book that was, you know, a structured glass of spring water, fresh spring water, on top of a book. And then he would let it sit on that book all night. And then in the morning, he would drink that water and then read the book.
Drink the water. All consciousness, you know, it's not the water that has the consciousness. It's the oxygen and the hydrogen and the nitrogen and the primary elements that have the consciousness. So water is overrated for consciousness because it's its constituent parts that actually have the consciousness.
It's the individual
parts. Water will work.
Wow.
Wow.
So that would be a great. Do you ever do that with reading? Do you apply some of these tactics, these
Is that a weird thing?
My way is getting up between 2:30 and 6 in the morning, which is download time, and then just get the information in the ether. Now, usually you get it by synchronicity. I just, if I wish to know something, I go on the internet. I can look up something about motorcycle maintenance and then find out something about how the liver works in that, because the information will go by synchronicity and give you the information.
Good.
So many times if I think of something, it just appears in a way. Like I douse libraries. I would need some information, read something, and then I would just go and wander through the library, and I found information on iridology in a book on petroleum science.
And so you, by douse, you mean you would just physically walk through and know that intuitively you're going to be directed
pick
to
the right book or
to
whatever.
The book you need.
And get a feeling of what I needed. You know, one time I decided to do it the librarian way, the our cultural way. I went to the computer. I needed the copyright dates for something I was doing for two books. So I went to and I looked them up. It took me about 10 minutes. And I said, well, that was pretty easy. I guess I'll do that next time. But then I thought, I'll just kind of wander through the library and see what I can find. Well, I found a book that looked interesting to me. I opened up. And in the index in the back were the references for these two unrelated books and their copyright dates. So I could have got it faster. Intuitionally than I did with the computer.
Oh my gosh.
That's wild.
Yeah, holy heck, there's something going on because Justin and I went a couple weeks ago to a book signing for Gabrielle Bernstein. She's written a couple books through Hay House. She's very interesting. And she wrote this book called Miracles Now, and she was encouraging everyone in the audience that whatever they need to open up the book just randomly, and usually it kind of meets you where you're at for that day or what position you're at in life. And I thought, so it's dark in there. There's candles. They're all chanting and stuff. And I thought, I'm just going to give this a try. I opened the book and I hold it up in the dim light, and it was something on surrendering. And I go, that's interesting. It was middle of the book, you know. So I shut it and thought, it kind of resonated with me. Well, about an hour later, I thought, I'm just going to try this again. I wonder. And of course, just kind of testing it, I open it up. Guess what page it is? It's surrendering again. And it was just so interesting to me because obviously there was no crease in the book. There was no specific, you know, it never been opened before, yet I was just drawn to this page. And it's, we so quickly want to kind of excuse those things as coincidence, but it doesn't seem to be at all, does it?
No, you're drawn to the page. And it's very interesting. When you push against the universe, it pushes back equally. The psychic surgeon, Errico, who actually removed cataracts in people's eyes, would jab the knife into the person's eye as hard as he could. And no matter how hard he jabbed it, the universe would jab back, and he would have the precise surgical application of a surgeon. Go onto the internet, look up Errico on YouTube, and watch some of the most interesting surgery you'll ever see.
How do you spell his
John
name?
Of God claims he can do that. I kind of doubt it, but Maybe so. Maybe I'll give him the benefit of the doubt. But Errico, I knew the scientist who investigated Errico, Dr. Poharich's friend, Henry Belk, who was a regular at the Phoenix Metaphysical Bookstore that I managed back in the 70s.
How do you spell Errico's last name?
Arrigo. They call him Z-Arrigo. Zearigo.
Okay.
He, the president of Brazil at that time was a medical doctor. He brought his daughter for healing to Arrigo, and he healed her.
In fact,
he pardoned him. They put the Catholic Church, which they didn't want someone else raising the dead, right? So he was a threat to the Catholic Church in Brazil, and he was a threat to the medical doctor. So they put him in prison, but the guards just opened the doors, and they lined up thousands of people would come to see him. I think he worked on several hundred people a day, if not more. And he said he was possessed by a German physician who would write prescriptions for them when he wasn't cutting cysts and cancers out of them with a rusty knife. That's why they called him the Surgeon of the Rusty Knife, and there's a book under that title too.
Isn't that wild? Did he have any influence or a connection with John of God since they're both in Brazil?
I think John of God, who used to do it one way, is now doing it the Errico way, and I think he basically just decided to copy that way. You know, you're more likely to be psychic if you're south of the equator because the Coriolis force tends to bring up magnetic forces more than life forces.
What force does that?
The Coriolis force, it's like in the northern hemisphere, you will notice that high pressure weather systems tend to go clockwise, uh-huh. and low pressure counterclockwise. It tends to reverse on the bottom of the Earth. So the so-called bottom of the Earth, and of course we're talking figuratively top bottom, as we're taught in school that the world is. There's no top or bottom. But down there, the forces reverse. They go against our blood flow, creating a magnetic force. Magnetic force is kundalini, and life force is called cosmodyne force. And cosmodyne force is the greater force. Kundalini force is restricted to the spine. Yogis go up the spine and they end up in their forehead and they never get any further. Cosmodyne force starts in the forehead, goes through the brain, ends up at the medulla oblongata, and ends up in the unified field. It's the greater force.
So that force goes through the – so the medulla oblongata is in the back of the head. Is that right?
The very back of the head, yes. And it's the assassin's point. Assassins use that point because it's the only now part of the brain, the only part that you can't yell. Any other place you're blasted in the brain, stabbed in the brain, shot in the brain, you will yell. Well, when it goes to the medulla, that's the place where the sperm met the ovum. You can't yell or shout. There's no time in the medulla.
It's almost like a
it's
like
called
a black
the mouth
hole.
Of God, in fact.
Yeah, fascinating. So I wanted to bring up this parasite cleanse, because you mentioned that a few minutes ago about parasites. Kate and I have been doing this parasite cleanse for only about, 5 or 6 days now? Mm-hmm. And it's by Body Force. We got it through a guy, a former guest of ours, Marcus Rothkranz, and it's a series of herbs that are encapsulated and it's supposed to just do wonders for parasites in terms of getting them out, but we've really been bloated lately.
And tired,
lots of cramps in the stomach. I would imagine that that has something to do with that cleanse, wouldn't it?
Yes, and sun synchronization, the ability to calibrate the sun with your own body. The passage of parasites has a lot to do with putting your body in flow. When people eat foods out of time, they actually put their body out of time. And in the same way you would time your car at idle speed so that it will, and also calibrate it so it will work maximally at higher speeds, you wouldn't go to your car mechanic and say, hey, I don't want you to time my car because I want you to save a few bucks and skip that. The mechanic would think you were crazy, and so would the greater population. But by timing our body, the parasites don't find a terrain to live in because the terrain is moving. You become a flowing river instead of a side pool with no exit where the moss and the algae and the fungi and the viruses and the bacteria multiply and multiply and multiply. By the way, theoretically, if you took certain bacteria and you multiplied them, in other words, they could multiply without any predator affecting them. Two bacteria together by the end of 3 weeks would go way past the solar system. They would cover the entire galaxy. That's how much potential multiplication value they have. It sounds phenomenal, but it's true. Obviously, thank goodness, they have predators, so we don't experience that.
Yeah, because they would just basically overtake the entire universe, wouldn't they?
Yes. Now, the predators are the very good bacteria we have in our body. It's called the microbiome. It actually, more than 10 times of the so-called cells in our body are actually parasites. They think our thoughts. That includes fungi, bacteria, and viruses. They're in there actually thinking our thoughts and affecting us. And they also war against each other. And the important thing is to make peace with the parasites that are going to help us. Like E. coli, most forms of E. coli are our friends. Most forms of acidophilus are our friends. But many of them have warlike tribes and fights within themselves. And the basic thing is to be a peacemaker in our own body and have them all get along and help us.
Yeah, because these things are part of our bodies. I heard recently, I've heard this for years, that we're, I think, more than 10 times not our own cells.
That's right. More than 10 times. The TB baculus cures cancer. Many of these viruses are our friends if we know how to use them and get them to work with each other cooperatively.
So when we're doing this cleanse, we should really think of it like we are assisting our bodies in moving these parasites out, not necessarily killing and fighting and warring against them.
Yes, and the trick is to learn to cleanse. If we were too pure, we would die. But to know how to cleanse is how we do it. If we get a parasite, we know how to get out of them. But one parasite just makes room for another one. Seven parasites come in return when the other parasite comes out there. But if we know how to keep them cleansing and moving, then we do. So what you're doing is one way of learning what works and what doesn't work, how the bloating affects you. And bloating can be simply eliminated by simply yawning, and by simply sneezing, and by farting, and by all kinds of methods like that. It's gas release. We are a two-holed system. We have an orifice on one end, an orifice on the other end, and that's the only way gas is going to come out.
Okay, wow. So this the pressure of the gas inside the cell is what's causing the cells to plump up and bloat, and then that makes your stomach stick out and all that?
Even it's the secret of weight control. I have a book called The Book of Bloat about that. That you know, there was a man in the Barlum and Bailey or one of those circuses back in the day. He would be a skinny man on stage, and he would just bloat himself up to a big, heavy man, and then he would shrink himself down several times a night. How did he do that? He had the secret of bloating. Many bodybuilders did that. I knew a bodybuilder that would gain 100 pounds for the powerlifting season and lose 100 pounds for the bodybuilding season.
Yeah, they seem to be magical that way, don't they?
It's called the pump. You know, you ever see a person goes to the gym, and they have a thin bicep, and then they pump it up, and there it's all swollen up. That's the pump. Well, our weight gain is based on the same principle, but they want to blame calories and, you know, there's every kind of diet out there that tells you how to lose weight, and they leave out gaseous pressurization totally. If you take a whale and you raise him in captivity, he never grows big, but you take him out in the ocean, as soon as he dives down, gets pressurized, he becomes a giant whale.
Wow.
Wow, there's something to the whole pressure thing. So the pressure thing could also put on, so when you're bloated, you could possibly be adding weight too.
That's right. You can, in fact, bodybuilders do it. They sculpt the bloating. It's sculpted bloating. Most people don't know how to sculpt it. They get it in the belly, the so-called Milwaukee goiter, or that big tire around the waist. That's actually gas. That's not fat.
Oh, God.
That's gas. The cell, they tell you the fat cell can expand 1,000 times. This is medical books now. Well, 1,000 times, what does it expand with? Gas, carbon dioxide gas, hydrogen sulfide gas, etc. Oh, you're a puppy dog.
Yeah, she's getting all excited.
See, the puppy dog knows what we're talking about.
I know. She's upset about something.
All the parasite talk.
So the cell itself can expand to 1,000 times. You don't hear that every day.
1,000 times. I mean, it's in medical books, but they never tell you what it expands with. That's the joke.
Wow. Huh. So you said something a little bit earlier. It was really interesting about how the parasites think our thoughts. Do you think there's something going on with this bacteria and this lack of beneficial probiotic flora, that and bad bacteria? Do you think there's an imbalance that's going on when people are depressed?
It's one of the reasons we have the word possession. We think of it as spirits and things. Some of them are the very bacteria that have taken over our body. Many of the bacteria that came, you know, they came from outer space. The sulfur-based bacteria, really called the archaeons, not really truly bacteria. And then the manganese-based bacteria came from outer space before there were ever oxygenators on this planet. The oxygen-based bacteria are a more recent addition to the terrestrial atmosphere.
Are those related to the fungus that have been found in space as well?
Yes, they are. Yep. They were. See, they didn't need oxygen. They actually metabolized things like sulfur and like methane and like magnesium and iron. They worked on those elements and not oxygen at all. The consciousness as we understand it is actually a basis of oxygen. If you don't have oxygen, you don't have consciousness. If you don't have hydrogen, you don't have desire. If you don't have nitrogen, you don't have will. And if you don't have carbon dioxide, you don't have attachment. And you can't make a diamond body.
What is that? Yeah, you mentioned that in an email to me at one point, a diamond body. What is that?
Diamond body means that we can actually stick around for a long time. It's called butterflyhood. And it's the we have a gland in our body called the butterfly gland. It's right around the level of the thymus. If you activate it, you get extended use. And people like Babaji in India, you know, he's managed to work at least 350 or so years out of that, maybe more.
Wow. So is that why your book, one of your books titled Butterflies Need No Taxidermist?
That's the word. Ah. So you can take it comes out of a caterpillar. That's our large intestine, where the consciousness is actually, the world's leading serotonin researcher was astonished to find out like about 95% or more of the serotonin in the body is not in the brain, like Dr. Amen would have us believe. Uh-huh. It's in the large intestine and the intestines. What the heck is it doing there? Well, that large intestine or a caterpillar, if you step on that caterpillar, it'll stink up the place. It'll rot. Mm-hmm. But a butterfly, you don't need to formaldehyde it. It's preserved. Because it's gone to a whole different state of existence. By the way, it has 14 breathing tubes akin to our 14 acupuncture meridian. It is an example of what our brain can do. We even have a butterfly brain, a butterfly bone in the brain, on the skull, and a butterfly in the brain that leads to higher consciousness.
So this guy that you mentioned in India that was living or is living, I'm not sure if he's still alive, for 350 years, do you think that's possible today?
Yes, it is, if people understand how to put their body in sun synchronization and how to go with the flow. You know, the term religion means to tie back, to retie. That's also the origin of the word yoga, to yoke back into what though? Into the environment. When you connect with the sun and the sun rhythm, and even the lunar rhythm partially, mm-hmm. you basically put your body back into synchronous flow. And that's really what people forget. They want to think of survival of the fittest, but actually, we're connected with the entire universe, and we can communicate with anybody or anything at any time. That's one of the yogic siddhis. If you've studied Patanjali, he goes into those various powers that we have that we forget we have.
The siddhis?
More and more quantum physicists are realizing we have the powers of Patanjali.
That's fascinating. So we can... Gosh, I don't even know where to go from there. So with people, I'm just thinking here about the people in the Bible. With it talks about how they live to 900 years old. Are there any other ancient texts that talk about people living like that?
Yes, they are. There's quite a lot. And you know, I met a man who claims he studied with Babaji in the Himalayas for about... let's see, for 2.5 years, I believe he studied with him. His story sounds pretty legitimate, but anyway, Babaji has been written about quite extensively. Many times, I think people make up the fact that they say that they found him. I'm not going to mention the names, but I think there's a lot of false stories out there. Uh-huh. As Rumi said, though, counterfeit gold means, or counterfeit money means there must be real money someplace, so it's based on truth.
Interesting. How do you spell Babaji?
B-A-B-A-J-I.
B-A-B-A-J-I.
And he had a sister, too. The man I know claims he met the sister, but he didn't study with her.
Hmm. Isn't that wild? Wow. That's so the diamond body is what you want to get to if you want to live. Could you imagine living? Kate and I, we talk about this all the time. It would be so fascinating because we often talk about, you know, those people in the Bible that is kind of common, more common in our culture in the West here. We talk about, you know, did these people, you know, if they lived till they're 900 years old, were they in a baby state, like a baby's body for the first 30 years, or were they in a 40-year-old body for the majority of their life? I wonder how they aged.
They can actually pick the stage they wish to. There's a man called, Sri Yukteswar. Sri Yukteswar was the guru of Paramahansa Yogananda, and he said he came back as an elderly man because people thought he was more guru-like like that. In my website, I grew a beard because people think you're more knowledgeable that way. Hmm. Now I don't have a beard, so you can imagine me without that beard.
Oh,
but people, you know, you have a beard, you figure you know more. It's not funny. And by the way, the mind is what keeps us from getting to the diamond body. It's a central principle of yoga that bondage is of the thinking substance only and is the failure to achieve the purposes of self. I am quoting Patanjali right out of yoga.
Wow, can you say that again? That's so fascinating.
Bondage is of the thinking substance only and is the failure to achieve the purposes of self. So I not only believe in mind over matter, I believe in self over mind.
Oh.
Wow.
Wow, that's a whole new concept.
Yeah, that's interesting. Jeez.
Self over mind.
Yeah, wow. And we had that in the West, too. Clement of Alexandria, who was one of the Catholic saints, he said, the Alpha and Omega, of whom alone the end becomes beginning and ends again at the original beginning without any break. That's the unified field he was talking about. See, they knew about quantum mechanics way before our modern science.
Well, they had to have known about this if they're doing all the sacred geometry and creating the Sri Yantra and the flower of life and all that, right?
That's right. And remember, the flower of light is only life is only the second chakra. It's basically the erectile principle. We call it Kundalini in the West.
So interesting.
And that's just the beginning of science. They just started out. Kundalini is no big deal. Yeah. It's a spare tire in our body.
I wanted to tell you too, Adam, we recently went to, I think we mentioned this perhaps on our last show, but we went to Texas to go see Dr. Stuart Nunley, and we had our root canals taken out. I had two of them, Kate had one, but she had these warts. I guess it would be
called... No, they're not. They're like not. These raised, I don't know what they are. They're not considered warts. They're like a growth on my left thumb, and ever since I've had my root canal out, they are like sinking back into my skin, almost disappearing. It's just the weirdest thing.
Well, there's a lot of acupuncture meridians tied into the jaw. On my one of my other websites, my solartiming.com, I have a chart of the dental muscles tied in. They affect muscles. They affect tissue of all sorts throughout the body, the acupuncture meridians, the reflex meridians. So, yeah, very important. That's why the tongue was used by ancient India in something they called the lion pose to point to certain teeth and control certain meridians. You know, the kidney meridian, you bring out and you touch the front canine teeth and you control the kidney.
Isn't that wild? The two front canine teeth.
Yep.
Wow. And so just by touching on those, they could reflex that energy back to the kidneys.
Yep, and you can go back to any meridian of the body but by where you touch your mouth. So the Indians knew the divine nectar came out of the mouth. They knew that the extension of the tongue and the various positions of the tongue controlled the body, mainly through partially through the hyoid bone, which is a U-shaped bone in the throat. That matches the alphabet. A for the for your perineum at the bottom of your spine. E for the sexual chakra. I for the intellectual chakra, which is the third chakra. O for the om or the heart chakra. And U or who for the throat chakra.
So
A-E-I-O-U. The esoteric meaning of those vowels of the alphabet.
So there's something going on there when you're saying those mantras or something like that during meditation.
Oh, definitely. You can recycle your brain by going through those letters. Just say A-E-I-O-U, and automatically you process yourself. Also, by going through the colors, you go through the following colors: black, gray, brown, red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, violet, white, and you recycle your brain. You're on the way to a parasite cleanse by doing that. It's called the kinetic rainbow, the kinetic color rainbow. It's not a static rainbow. You go through it, and automatically you evolve the brain by simply going through those colors, because the energy of red is much more solid than the energy of violet. The energy of red, in fact, is in the traffic signal. It's the stop sign, the international symbol of stop. Mm-hmm. When you see red, you stop. If you have a business and you want people to stop, you put a red sign up, and their subconscious mind gravitates toward the gas pedal. So you paint the sign in yellow so they see it, and then red so they stop, because otherwise they'll just see the sign and say, "Oh, nice sign," and drive by your business.
Yeah, yeah. Like
you're right.
Like Tana says in the chat room, emergency paramedics, fire trucks, they're all red.
They're all red. And by the way, they raise blood pressure. All the trauma units use a blue light to reduce blood pressure when they pick the person up.
Wow.
Color therapy, very powerful. All the trauma, they would never use a red light. They'd have a lot more people dying in emergency vehicles on the way to the hospital.
Wow.
Yeah, interesting. Power of color.
Interesting.
Yep. And blue is the color, of course, that gives us macular degeneration. We have an epidemic of it going on because our computer screens are blue. That's why you can get filters for them now through Mac and through various chemical companies. Some people wear blue blocker glasses at night. We're under an epidemic because of LEDs, fluorescent light, and full spectrum lighting should not be used during the night. It causes a variety of diseases.
Yeah, we know we had a guy on, I forget what his name, Dr. Richard Hansler, I think, and he talked about the blue light. And then a while back, a guy named Dr. Jack Cruz was on, and he said that those computer programs, although very, very helpful and very good for him, he feels that they're not strong enough, and so he wears those blue blocker sunglasses even with those computer programs. But that's what I do, and it seems to work really well.
Yes, there's another way to protect yourself. You know, we're mostly on the sun clock, but we're also on the food clock. So if you time your food clock by taking tomato juice, molasses, a bit of cheese, and a pickle at 2 o'clock exactly p.m., you switch over to the time clock. Then if you synchronize your exercise program to the clock, you have two clocks working against the solar clock, so then you can largely ignore the solar clock. Now, the highest choice is to pay attention to the solar clock, the uh-huh. exercise clock, and the food clock, and then you have healthful flow and longevity.
So we should talk about that maybe on our next show, doing some more timing stuff with that, because I know I've heard you talk about there's a specific time to exercise, you know, for if you want to put on muscle, and then a different time to exercise if you want to lose weight. So maybe we'll get into some of that. That sounds like a lot of fun.
Definitely. A new website is coming out soon, and the timing will be under the name SunSync Nutrition. Look for it very soon. I'll send you an email when it's up. It could be up any day. It might be a month. We'll see.
I'd love that.
It's in process right now.
And that's a new project you're working on.
That's right. A brand new website, maybe a couple of them.
Wow. That's so cool.
That'll be the third website, and three's a charm.
I know. I was going to say this, something with the three.
You're onto something there, Adam.
The numbers we have? We have things, you know, four is stability. We base our house geometry on it. Uh-huh. And by the way, the third chakra is built on the triangle because it's the color chakra. And where did they discover how color works? In the prism. It's just a fancy triangle.
Wow. Wow, there's so much here. This is just a fodder for another show. We're going to have to do this again, Adam. This is
always
too good. This is too good. I've got a million questions for you.
I'm for it. We'll juice up the world.
We'll juice up the world.
I love that phrase.
I love it. Well, thank you so much for being on and for sharing all this great information. I just feel like it's just so empowering, and I just love it. Thank you.
Thanks for the opportunity.
All right, hold on the line there, Patrick. Or I'm sorry, not Patrick, but
Adam
for staying on the line there. We're going to close out our live show. So for everybody who's listening live, we appreciate you so much for being in the chat room. It makes it so much more fun.
That was fun. Thanks, guys.
Yeah, and it's just so great. So thank you so much for listening live. And what we're going to do on this show page, which is 246, is we'll put a link to the forum. And if you have any questions about anything that Adam said, we will post a link to a specific thread in the forum where you can continue to talk about this particular show. So we'll put that as soon as the show page is posted. So I want to thank everyone for listening live and supporting us and supporting our work. It really means so much to us, and just we appreciate it so much. So thank you so much for listening. We'll catch you on the next episode. Adam, are you still there?
I am still here.
Oh, excellent. Thanks for hanging on. I appreciate that. It took us a couple seconds to close down the live show. Appreciate that. Oh, my gosh. That was so much fun. We're going to start out talking about, or we were going to talk about color, and look, we just went off on a tangent.
You know, I prefer serendipity and spontaneity, so it worked out like it did.
Well, I always have a million questions, so this is easy for me. I hope it's good for you.
Oh, yeah. I like it.
Oh, so it's always fun.
Awesome.
Thanks,
well, thanks, Adam. We appreciate it so, so much.
Same here. And until next time.
Until next time.
Blue skies and green lights.
Love it. Thanks, Adam.
Love it.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye-bye.
Wow. I don't even know what to say about that.
Are my eyeballs still in my head? I feel like they're bug-eyed from just looking at you with amazement and sheer shock.
So incredible. Where does he get that information?
I don't know. And I just want to know if he's a sponge. Like, talks about going to the library and picking all these things up through all these years. But if I go to the library and read a book, I have a hard time just retaining the information from a chapter. Let alone, I mean, every show we've had him on, he has enough information to fill another show and probably days and days and days and days of shows without repeating the same thing twice.
Yeah, we could just talk with him.
If
the energies would allow, we could just talk to him for hours, probably days, if not months, of all the stuff that he knows. I just don't understand. I wonder, I have a feeling that he, I don't know, there's something special about him.
I mean, you think?
Yeah, there's something definitely, I don't know, otherworldly or other dimensional about Mr. Adam Bergstrom.
I agree.
He's just so, he's got information that you're not going to hear anywhere other than different, you know, times that he gives this stuff out or at his books or his website or other interviews. But this type of thing, I mean.
Yeah, I just don't understand.
I know, right?
My mind just reels. I'm picking up little tidbits and applying them and actually understanding them, but the depth of knowledge that man has just blows. It makes my mind spin.
How about
my
that?
Chakras are spinning.
How about
Maggie's trying to lay on the things down there, the quartz.
Oh,
okay.
Okay, it's still broadcasting.
Okay.
How about the old Garden of Eden being San Diego?
Well, I know people love San Diego. Maybe that's why.
I know, right?
Never heard that one before.
Yeah.
Have you ever heard that?
No, I never heard that before.
Wow.
And what did you think about...
I wonder what that's based off of.
Yeah, he said a couple of people have written some books, right, about
yeah.
that?
Yeah. Hmm.
But, yeah, I don't know. That seems just wild. I mean, it's... man, what do you think about all that stuff he said about education? I couldn't agree more with what he said.
Yeah, absolutely.
I feel like he was probably holding back, too, because he doesn't seem to have a good...
What was interesting, he said he would... What he knows... If he were to do things with a child nowadays, it would be self-education. And you turned around and said, so that would involve homeschooling and things. Mm-hmm. But I'm thinking he was thinking even more like, let the kid educate themselves. Let them be self-motivated. Let them be let them be their own digger of what's interesting to them.
Self-talk.
Along with the unschooling thing. That
you look at a guy, you look at people like, you know, that Wernher von Braun from, you know, who was part of the... you know, a space thing, and you know, people, just scientists, Albert Einstein, these types of people, it seems like they would have done their profession, their career, regardless of school. I mean, they're just wired that way. They just have that desire to want to know math and all that kind of stuff. And so it seems like if people have this innate wiring mm-hmm. to do things that they're passionate and love, I understand that schooling to some degree sharpens iron, and you want to get the cutting edge knowledge, but I don't know. I mean, people are going to do what they want to do, regardless of whether or not the school is there, you know? And it kind of reminded me of the show we did with Dana Martin on unschooling.
That's what I was just saying.
Yeah, that was pretty fascinating.
Yeah, the things that are in them that are going to unfold, they come out with it all in them. Now it's just like, it's not so much growing into them, it's just unfolding into these things. The things that you're interested in will naturally
just come out.
Mm-hmm. And you'll gravitate toward those things. And
so, Kay,
tend to believe it.
You and I must be living somewhat of an inspired life because what did he say? It's more vertical rather than linear when you see these types of numbers like mm-hmm. we do all the time. Because
mm-hmm.
we've had our friend Bo here from myorganiclife.info and she stayed with us for a couple weeks and she had never had any kind of number thing going on. And now she's emailing you with all these numbers that she's seeing every day. They're double, triple, quadruple numbers.
I know.
11, 11.
And we're just laughing. And she goes, it's definitely catchy. It's like, and Tana was saying during the chat room that her husband sees it all the time, but she doesn't.
Really?
And I'm like, just wait. It's funny with you and I in our situation, it was like probably 6 to 8 months of me talking about how crazy it was before it started happening to you.
Right.
So I'm wondering if you were just more open to it and that's what started happening to you, or if in some relationships it just won't be that way for people. Like one person will always see them, the other person never will. I have no idea. I don't know. I wanted to tell her, like, you just wait, you know, but I don't know if it's now that she's aware of it, it might happen, or it just might not. Maybe that's just not her path. I'm not sure.
I wonder if it has something to do with not just doing what you want to do and being passionate about your work and your purpose in life, but connecting with that. Because I had already been doing this show, and I feel like this show and putting out this kind of information for me is my life's work.
Right.
And so I'd already been doing that for about 6-8 months prior to, you know,
me joining the show.
Well, no, prior to me seeing those numbers.
Oh, that way.
And so even though I was doing the work that I loved and felt inspired every day doing that work, I feel like it was around that time when I started seeing those numbers that I became more connected with that being my mission and more in alignment with doing the kind of work that I know is helping people.
Mm.
And so even though I was already doing it, I felt more aligned with it. And maybe it was at that point, I feel like it was at that point where I started seeing those numbers too. So maybe it's becoming more, even if you're doing what you want to do and you are doing your life's work, but becoming more in line with that as your mission in life. And that's what really feeds you. I think when you get more incongruent with that, then that's when you start seeing the numbers.
Yeah.
At least that's the way for me.
Yeah, it's a bummer for the people, though, that think that they are and they still don't have those situations.
Yeah,
because I'm so excited to feel like, I feel like I was saying in the chat room to some people, like, I feel like it's God just patting me on the back saying, keep going, you're in the right place. Like,
yep.
That's how I take it.
Yeah, totally.
So obviously, who doesn't want that? But I think we just all have different ways of
experiencing
being communicated to, I guess.
Yeah, exactly. Because some people it's dreams and other people it's other. You know, people, synchronistic circumstances that happen. Meeting certain people, all that kind of thing.
Absolutely.
Good
it's not
stuff.
It's not all what's it called? Is it by accident?
No, it's not. Gosh, good stuff. Well, I love Adam Bergstrom.
I do too. He's so interesting.
He's so good.
So interesting.
Ah, now I gotta unwind a little bit and figure out how I'm gonna understand all this information.
I don't know if I'll ever understand it.
So I want to thank all of you guys for listening, being in the show, in the live show, in the chat room, and then participating in the forums. This is episode 246, and we broadcast live Monday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday at 9 a.m. Pacific time. So you're always welcome to join the forum. I'm sorry, join the chat room. It's free to be in there. You don't have to put your email address or anything. The forum is also free. All you got to do is register for an account. And you can continue any discussions about your health issues or any particular shows. You can join the other incredibly smart and talented and amazingly
knowledgeable
people who listen to Extreme Health Radio. It's quite an amazing community of people we have. So if you want to join the forum, you can do that. And also, as the lady said during the show, we're 100% listener supported. So if you'd like to support us either through Amazon or we accept donations, if you go to extremehealthradio.com/donate, you can send a little donation if that's something that you're interested in doing. Helps to pay the bills around here, which are always increasing. Like, for example, this chat room we pay $20 a month for, and that's a new cost.
Feature.
New feature, yeah. So all this stuff costs money, and it's our way of showing appreciation to you guys, offering it for free. So and then it allows people who really need the information to get it and not have to pay. So we do accept donations. Then we also have a store as well with tons of cutting edge products like the Rebounder, saunas, the
biomat,
all kinds of really interesting things, blenders and juicers, all kinds of really cool stuff. So you can always check out our store. But in any event, I hope you guys are having a great day wherever you are in the world. And it's time for us to, what are you going to do?
I am going to go actually pick up our biomat from a friend that we loaned it to because I can't live without that thing.
Yeah, we loaned it to him yesterday.
You and I love that biomat. So I'm going to go grab that and then I'm going to go to the strawberry farm.
Oh, cool.
And go get some organic strawberries for the day and get my day going after that.
Do you want to, have you walked Maggie yet?
No.
Do you want to walk her first?
No.
Or you want to, you don't?
I want to hit the road. I'll do it after.
Okay.
Yeah.
So we'll give her 2 walks today.
We'll find out. Maybe you can walk her.
Okay. Awesome. All right, everybody. Thank you so much.
Thanks, guys.
For joining us. Episode 246. We'll catch you
on the next. And it's 1044 and we'll catch you next time.
My gosh. See, there it is.
I know.
My goodness. 1044.
Oh, brother.
Let me look at the seconds.
Perfect way to exit the day.
And
the show.
Well, it was 3 seconds shy of 1044:44. Good night. Oh, my gosh.
Holy Mother of Pearl.
And it continues.
And it continues.
So thank you, everybody, for joining us. And we will catch you on the next episode.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you for listening to this episode.
It's time to go for now, but our mission does not end with this show.
Justin and Kate will be back with another interview packed full of ideas, discoveries, and unique ways to regain your health.
Head on over to extremehealthradio.com/subscribe and instantly download our free gift too that contains cutting-edge strategies to start making healthy lifestyle changes today.
No material on this blog is intended to suggest that you should not seek professional medical care. Always work with qualified medical professionals, even as you educate yourself in the field of live food nutrition and alternative medicine. I'm not a doctor, nor am I offering readers or listeners medical advice of any kind. None of the information offered here should be interpreted as a diagnosis of any disease, nor an attempt to treat or prevent any disease or condition. While information in this blog and during this podcast is discussed in the context of numerous conditions,